Welcome viewers. Today we will discuss about the velocity in mechanism, that is a part of your course Kinematics and Dynamics of Mechanism. The code of this course is BME020, and this is a course of third year student of BTEC Mechanical in Computer Integrated Manufacturing. When we talk about this subject, then certainly the few things which comes to our mind, that is, what is machine, why we study about the kinematics and dynamics of mechanism, then what is kinematics, what is dynamics, and after all, why we are studying it. The purpose to study this, that we want to study the motion between the two parts of a machine when the force is acting on them. There are different types of motion which normally occurs between the different mating parts of the machines. So it's very important then when we design a machine, then it is very, very important that we should know that when we are applying a force or it is working on certain mechanism, that what are the different forces which act on this, and as a result of these forces, what is the relative motion between the mating parts of the machines. If we are able to know the motion, then we can always be able to determine the velocity because of one part which is moving. So it's very, very important that we should analyze that what are the different types of mechanism, how the basic elements, or what are the different basic elements of a mechanism or machine. Basically, the initial structure is a link, which is a very elementary, just like in a human being, we have a cells. Similarly, for a machine, the basic element is a link. Then, when two links are combined or coupled, then there is a formation of kinematic pair. And when the different kinematic pairs are combined, then there is a formation of chain. And when the chain, we fix one link of the chain, then the mechanism is formed. So basically, when we are going to study the theory of machines, it is also known as theory of machines. So, but in your course, we have kept is especially on the recommendation of expert that it is a kinematics and dynamics of mechanism. So in today's session, we are focusing on the some basic concepts of the theory of machines, and then we finally come to the different or the various methods of determining the velocity. Basically, there are two methods of determining the velocity in a mechanism. The first is known as your instantaneous center method, and another one is your relative velocity method. So in today's lecture, we will cover both of them, as well as we will also cover that how to determine the acceleration in the mechanism. So first we will see that, after all, what is theory of machines? If you see the slide, it's basically a branch of engineering science which deals with the study of relative motion between the various parts of a machine. So if you say that what is theory of machines, it's basically a science, or it is a branch of science in which we study the relative motion between the various parts of the machine while they are in motion. Now the question comes to our mind that what is machine? It's a simply a device which converts the energy into some useful work. And the second important characteristics of the machine is that it consists of number of parts of the body. Then we should know that what is the rigid and the resistant body. A body is said to be rigid. This is a rigid body. We can say that this body is a rigid body if it does not suffer any distortion between these two points. Suppose A and C is the point, or B and C is the point. We can say that this body is a rigid body if there is a little bit, or you can say negligible distortion between these two points. And the second important point is that the resistant bodies. Every body cannot be a rigid body. for our practical purpose and when for the purpose of studying the kinematics and dynamics of mechanism, we take the resistant body. Resistance body are those basically which are rigid for the purpose they have served. Now we come to the kinematic pair. It's a basically kinematic pair is formed when two links or elements of machines are in contact with each other, or we can say the relative motion between them is completely or successfully constant. Here I would like to specify that what do you mean by the completely constant motion or successfully constant motion. That means that if the motion, if you are guiding or some force is acting on that particular linkages and the motion is according to the force acting on that, then we can say that it is a completely or successfully constant. In our daily life or in our practical life, we also face the motion when the motion of the body is irrespective of the direction of the force. Means that we are applying the forces, but the motion is in different planes. For example, if we put a cylinder in a hollow bar and we just rotate, then it rotates as well as it reciprocate. So the motion is not completely restrained or constrained. So such type of motion is called the incompletely constrained motion. If we fix up something or we add some mechanism so that it only rotates, it does not reciprocate, then the motion we can say that it is a completely constant or successfully constant. So the kinematic pair, when we are trying to define the kinematic pair, then basically we are coupling the links together so that our motion is completely or successfully constant. So the definition, or you can say the condition for having the kinematic pair, the first, there is a coupling of two links, and another one is that the motion between the two links must be either completely constant or successfully constant. Now we will see our next slide. That after the kinematic pair, when we combine the kinematic pair, then there is a formation of kinematic chain. If the last link is joined with the first link to transmit the different motion, then we say that it is a kinematic chain. Now these are the condition for the kinematic chain, that is 2p minus 4. The p is the number of pair, l is the number of linkages or number of links. So if we take that l is equal to 4 and in that number of pair is 4, so the left hand side must be equal to right hand side, then we can say that the condition for being a kinematic chain is satisfied, and we can say that particular bar or particular combination of the bar is a kinematic chain. Then we come to the mechanism. Now what is mechanism? Mechanism can be defined as a closed kinematic chain in which the one link is fixed. A kinematic chain which forms a mechanism should have the constant motion. Now there are two methods of determining the velocity of a point on a link. First is known as instantaneous center method, and another one is called the relative velocity method. So first we will take the instantaneous center method. That is, if these are the two points in a linkages, or we can say that AB is a linkage, the velocity of A is in this direction, that is VA, and the velocity of B is in the direction, that is VB. If we draw the perpendicular, it intersects at point P. So if we resolve this VB along the line, we will get the VB cos phi, and if we resolve the VA along this line, we get the VA cos theta. Now if we divide, since the motion between these links is negligible, or you can say that there is no relative motion between point B and A. Therefore, the resultant velocity of this link is zero towards this axis. That means that VB cos beta minus VA cos alpha should be zero. Or we can write it in this way, that VA cos alpha should be equal to VB cos beta. Or we can simplify this equation by dividing it by VB, or we get VA upon VB is equal to sin 90 minus sin beta upon sin 90 minus sin alpha. And if we apply the Lamy's theorem in the triangle AIB, then we get AI upon this angle, that is sin 90 minus beta, then BI upon this angle, that is sin 90 minus alpha. And we get, by if we combine this equation, we get the VA upon AI and VB upon BI is equal to VC upon AI. The purpose for this analysis is this, that in a link, if there are two points and the body is in a translation motion as well as rotation motion, so we can assume that the complete motion of the body is purely rotation about a point, and this point is known as instantaneous center. Then why we are calculating this thing? We want to know the distance between the instantaneous center and a point on a body, so that if we know the direction of the velocity and the velocity of another point in both magnitude as well as in direction, we can find out the velocity in magnitude of any point in the linkage. So this is the basic for determining the instantaneous center. Now this is very easy to say, that first determine the instantaneous center and then calculate or determine the velocity. But first step is to know or find out the number of instantaneous center in the linkages or in the mechanism. So in the next slide we will see that the different types of instantaneous center or the properties of instantaneous centers. If you see our slide, that since the rigid link rotates instantaneously relative to another link at the instantaneous center, two rigid links have no linear velocity relative to each other. What does it mean? That if you have two linkages and they are just like having the relative, or they are combined or they are joined at a certain point, then the first important point is that they rotates relative to that instantaneous center. But in the meantime, these two links joined at instantaneous center does not have or do not have the relative motion between them. These are the two important characteristics of the instantaneous center. Now we will come that what are the different types of the instantaneous center. If you see the slide, there are three types of basically instantaneous centers. First is called the fixed instantaneous center, second one is the permanent instantaneous center, and third one is the neither permanent nor fixed instantaneous center. Now if we define all these three instantaneous center, the first one is known as the fixed instantaneous center. As we told you that in a mechanism or in a kinematic chain, when we fixed a link, then we have the mechanism. Now the instantaneous center at the fixed link is called the fixed instantaneous center, and other instantaneous center which are permanent in their position, they are called the permanent. And there are other instantaneous center whose position is neither fixed nor permanent, they are come under the third category. Now if we see this figure, this is link 1 and this is link 2, then our instantaneous center will lie at the intersection of this point. So if we have such type of linkages joining at this point, then the intersection of these two links will denote the position of the instantaneous center. Now we can have also such type of situation when one link is fixed while another is rotating, and remember, without slipping, then the instantaneous center lies at the point of contact. Means if this is link 1 and this is link 2, the point of contact is this one, so our instantaneous center will lie, that is I12 will lie at the point of contact. This is the point of contact. Third type of instantaneous center is the sliding motion. This is a fixed link and the link 2 is sliding on the fixed link. Now these are the two velocity, two points when the velocity is parallel to the sliding motion, and if we draw the perpendicular, they will not meet at any point. So basically the instantaneous center will lie at infinity. So we can see in our different mechanism that such type of situation always occur, because in most of the cases we have a different linkages, then we have a slider crank mechanism, so we have a sliding motion. If we have a sliding motion, then definitely the instantaneous center between the two linkages will lie at the infinity. Another type of we always face, that when we have a circle and the motion of this is inside the circle. Now the instantaneous center will occur at the radius of curvature for this curve. Now we will come to the Kinematic theorem. Now first we will see that what is Kinematic theorem and what is its importance. Basically Kinematic theorem helps in determining the position or the location of the instantaneous center. So first we say that if three bodies move relatively to each other, they have three instantaneous centers and they lie on the straight line. Suppose we have a three linkages, that is 1, 2 and 3, and they have relative motion, so their instantaneous center will lie on a straight line. Now we will see its proof. Suppose there is a linkage A, B and C. Now the instantaneous center between A and B lies at here and it is known as IAB. This is instantaneous center between link A and C, it is IAC. And similarly IBC is the linkage between B and C. So these are three link which have relative motion with each other. Now we will come to this point, that is IBC. Now if this point is moving with relative to this IAB, then the direction of this velocity VBC will be the perpendicular to this link and the magnitude will be VBC. And if we take this point on this link C, the relative motion will be in this direction and the motion or the direction of the velocity will be the perpendicular to this link and will be in this direction. Now see that the point is 1 and the direction of velocity will be definitely 1, but here we are getting the two direction of the velocity. One is in this direction, another one is this direction. This contradict our basic assumption that the relative velocity of a link is always perpendicular to the link. So therefore it is only possible when this point lies on this link. This means that these three links must have three instantaneous center which lies on the straight line. That is not possible to have the instantaneous center outside the line joining three instantaneous centers. Now we will come to a example of, we will take an example that how we can locate the instantaneous center, and also we will try to find out that how can we calculate the velocity of a link. So if we see this example, that this is a well-known example. This is your slider crank mechanism, where this is your crank, this is your connecting rod. The length of the connecting rod as well as the connecting rod will be given to you. The direction of or the position of a crank at a particular time will also be given, that is 45 degree. So first of all, we have to draw the space diagram. So here we have to find out the velocity of slider A as well as velocity, angular velocity of connecting rod AB. This is your connecting rod, and this is the basic mechanism in every your theory of machine mechanism. So now we know that angular velocity of our crank is 10 radian per second. The length of crankshaft is 100 millimeter. We can convert into the meter, that is 0.1 meter. The velocity of crank OB we can find out by multiplying it with the radius, that is omega OB. We have given that is 10 radian per second, and the OB is 0.1. So we have find out the velocity of crank as 1 meter per second. Now we will come to the second slide, and we will try to find out the location of instantaneous center. Now the first purpose is that what is the number of instantaneous center. Here the number of linkages are 4, just like 1 link here, 2 link here, 3 link here, and 4 is this one. So we have a 4 link. So n is the number of link, so we can calculate with this formula the number of link, and it comes as a 6. So 4 is the number of linkages, 4 multiplied by 4 minus 1, that is 4 into 3, 12 divided by 2, and it comes as a 6. So in this mechanism the total number of instantaneous center is 6. So we have to find out 6 instantaneous center. Now the next step is to find out the fixed and the permanent instantaneous center by inspection. Now just see that this is link 3 and this is link 4. So as we told you that fixed instantaneous center lie at the intersection, so I34 will lie at this point. Similarly, I23 or permanent instantaneous center will lie at the intersection of this link 3 and link 2, that is I23, and the third instantaneous center I12 which lie at the intersection of crank and the fixed position, that is I12. So now we have find out the three instantaneous center. Now our objective is to find out more number of instantaneous center. And another one is that I14 that will lie at the infinitive, because we have already studied that the instantaneous center for the sliding mechanism will lie at the instantaneous center. Just see, this line will lie or it will not intersect anywhere, so the instantaneous center will lie at the infinitive. So we have find out four instantaneous center, that is I23, I12, I34 and I14. So the total number of instantaneous center which we have to find out is 6, but we have find out 4 instantaneous center. Now our main work is to find out the remaining 2 instantaneous center. Now we will see in the next slide that how we will find out the remaining 2 instantaneous center. So for that purpose we draw this circle of any radius, and we divide this circle into the 4 parts, that is 1, 2, 3 and the 4. These all 4 lines basically show the instantaneous center which you have already determined. Suppose we take the example of instantaneous center 1, that is I12, this we have already determined. I23, this instantaneous center, which exist at the intersection of connecting rod and the crankshaft. Similarly, I34, which occurs or exists between the slider and the connecting rod, and finally the instantaneous center, which is at the infinitive, that is I14. Now our main objective is now to find out the remaining instantaneous center, that is I13 and I24. This is the instantaneous center number 5 and this is instantaneous number 6. Now what to do for this? For determining the instantaneous center I13, you have to extend the line joining instantaneous center 1-2 and instantaneous center 2-3. Similarly, you have to extend the line joining instantaneous center I14 and I34, then you will get the instantaneous center I13. Now we have extend the line I12 and I23, and they intersect this line joining I34 and I4 at this point, so we will get the instantaneous center I13. Now for calculating or for determining the instantaneous center I26, we have to extend the line joining instantaneous center I12 and I14. Similarly, we have to extend the line I23 and I34. Now see, where is the I23 and I34? So we have to extend this line and we have to extend the line joining I14 and I12. So let us see what will happen. So this line, after extending, this is intersecting at this line. So our instantaneous center I24 will lie at this. Now up till now we have calculated, we determined all the 6 instantaneous center for this slider crank mechanism. Now our purpose, our main goal is to find the velocity of slider A and the angular velocity of connecting rod AB. Now we will see that how we will find the velocity. By measurement we find that I3A is equal to 460 mm, or if we convert, that is 0.46 mm, and I13B, this line is 560 mm, that is 0.56. So after determining, you have to measure the length of the distance between the instantaneous center and the point A. Similarly, point B and I13 you have to measure, but here you have to be careful in your drawing. Now velocity of a slider, that is VA, we know the formula that VA upon I13A, this distance will be equal to the velocity of point B and the distance, and this is nothing but the angular velocity, that is omega A and omega B. By measurement we have already calculated. Now we can use this formula and we can find out the velocity of A, that is the velocity of slider, by putting the values, and it is coming as 0.82 m/s. Similarly, we can find out the angular velocity of connecting rod AB, that is omega B. Again we know the velocity, or the angular velocity, is equal to VA upon I13. So we simply put the values of VB and I13 and we can find out the angular velocity, that is 1.78 rads/s. Now we will come to the second part, that is the determining the velocity of a point on a link by relative velocity method. Before going into detail, we first see that what is the relative velocity. Suppose there are two points A and B. A and B both are moving and velocity of VA is greater than VB. So we can say the relative velocity of this A will be VA minus VB if they are moving in the same direction, just like this, that they are moving in the same direction. So VAB will represent the absolute velocity of A with respect to B, or we can say the velocity of B with respect to A. If they are in the same direction, then we can take the vector difference and we can say that the VA minus VB, both are the vector quantity. So here we have to take the extra precaution while calculating this velocity. Now the relative velocity of B with respect to A is VB minus VA, or we can say that the distance AB is equal to OB minus OA. So these are the vector sum, it is not the simple algebraic sum. Now suppose a body B is moving in an inclined direction. First we have seen that when the body, both bodies are moving parallel to each other. Now in this condition, the body A is moving in this direction, but body B is moving in inclined direction. So we can take the help of your famous parallelogram theorem, that first we draw a line OB. Since we know the velocity of B, we know the direction of this velocity, we draw this line and this line, and we can find out the relative velocity of point A with respect to B. Or if we repeat again, then first we draw the this point is called the pole, and from pole A we just draw a line which is equal to the magnitude of VA and in a direction of VA. Then we draw the line parallel to the direction of VB and in the magnitude of this one, and we join this point A and B, we get the velocity, relative velocity of point A with respect to point B. Or if you can also here say the relative velocity of B with respect to point A. Now if we see that this is a link and this is a one, we are focusing on this. This is point A and this is point B, and the point B has a direction of velocity in this direction, that is VBA, and the velocity or angular velocity is omega. Now we can draw the line parallel to the direction of velocity, that is AB. And if we have a point C, we can find out using the proportionate theorem the point C, and this AC or BC will denote the velocity of point B with respect to C, or AC the velocity of C with respect to point A. So in this way we can find out the velocity by using the relative motion. Now you see that when we are saying that VBA, that is omega into AB, where omega is the angular velocity, and this shows the velocity of point B with respect to point A. And if we say that it is CA, that is omega into AC, then we say that velocity of point C with respect to A. Now we can take the ratio to find out that VCA upon VBA must be equal to the distance between point A and C and distance between point AB. And here we can say that it is equal to omega times AC and omega times AB. Since both case omega is similar, so we can cancel it and we can come to the AC upon AB. So here the conclusion is that the ratio of the velocity of different points is equal to the distance from the main point, that is point A. So we can easily find out by using the proportionate theorem. Now we will come to know the velocity of a point by the relative velocity method. This is your point B and this is point A. Now the direction of velocity of point A is VA in this direction. Velocity of point B is VB is in this direction. Now If the velocity of B is known only in direction, the velocity of B may be determined by drawing the velocity diagram. So in the relative velocity method, we draw the velocity diagram. Now see, this is your link and this is the direction of A, this is the direction of velocity for B. VB is only known in direction, not in magnitude, while the velocity of VA is known in the direction as well as the magnitude. So first we take a pole, that is our starting point. From this point we draw a line which is parallel to the direction of VA and in the equal magnitude of VA. So we find the point A, and this represents the velocity of A. Now we draw the line perpendicular to AB, and we also draw the line from point O which is parallel to VB. That is, we draw the line parallel to VB and then we draw the line perpendicular to AB. Both line intersect at point B, which gives you the magnitude of velocity VB as well as relative velocity of A with respect to B or B with respect to A. And suppose we take a point C here, we take the proportion of AC times BC and we find out this position, and if we join this point with O, we can find out the velocity of point C with respect to O. Now if we have another point D, we simply join with A and simply join with B, and we draw the line parallel to AD and parallel to BD. Just like C, we have drawn the line parallel to this and parallel to this one. So we got the point D, and if we join this point, this will give you the magnitude as well as the direction of velocity D. Now we again come to the same type of a problem which we have discussed. Here the velocity of A is to be determined. Similarly, we have to determine the velocity, angular velocity of connecting rod AB. We only know the velocity of point B, that is the crankshaft, and the angular velocity and the radius, and also a position of the crankshaft at a particular location. Now we will first see that how we will draw. We just take a point O and we draw a line parallel to A. Then we take a point O again, we draw the line parallel to VB in the magnitude which we have determined by multiplying omega with R. R is the radius of crankshaft. So from this point we draw the line perpendicular to AB. Now this line will intersect at point A, and this line will give you the magnitude of velocity of slider, that is A. So in today's lecture we have focused on some basic definitions of the kinematics and the dynamics of mechanism. Then we have focused on the two different methods of determining the relative velocity of a point on a link. The first method is the instantaneous center method, and second one is the relative velocity method. In the instantaneous center method, we use the Kennedy's theorem to determine the number of instantaneous centers, and once we know the distance between instantaneous center and that point, we can easily determine the velocity of any point. In the relative velocity method, we draw the velocity diagram, and we can determine not only the velocity of a point in the leakage, as well as we can also determine the velocity of any point outside the link with the help of relative velocity method. Thank you.